I would respond to them, probably on that same PDF file. But I guess what else, that's about, as the last time I checked, about 13 students gave some feedback as to what's going on. Things seem to be mostly going fine, but as I said, I'll make things available to you, and there aren't many concerns as far as I know. Okay, there was one concern. One of the students said it would be most useful to have a video subtitled. I think it's a personal failing on Tom's part that he's not also subtitling the videos. But really, I think the problem is it's the international students here cannot deal with my Arizona accent. And so, I could try to help them by speaking in non-Arizona accent, but as you know from New York Times, Arizona, apparently, if you don't speak in Arizona accent, you'll be thrown out from the schools. So I have to speak in Arizona accent, so you just have to deal with it. And then some of you said, speak fast, you just have to listen fast. That's the usual thing. Of course, the video can be slowed down again. By the way, the other thing, you know, more seriously, think of this as yet another, apart from the GRE vocabulary that I taught you last time, imagine that I'm, you know, making you ready for workplace, you know, because if you go to workplace in Silicon Valley, you're not going to get Midwestern accent. Once in a while you will hear it, but you'll hear a cacophony of accents. So you just have to get used to it. So even though they are not paying me to get you a good Indian accent, I'm doing it free. Many people actually said they waste time watching the video after the class. I think you guys should be thankful for Tom. All I need to do is put on some makeup before coming to class. He has to take his notes as well as actually pass the video. So he's the flip master of the class as of now. And I think he's done a very good job when I looked at some of them. When I'm writing stuff on the board, he's actually zooming in, etc. So, you know, when I asked, could somebody volunteer? There was like deafening silence in the class. That's all I want you to remember. Okay. Anyway, I'll give you more. I mean, as I said, all the things that I got to see, you get to see on these comments. I'll just put it up. So if you have nothing else to do, you can read them all. But otherwise, I think not too much of concern right now. So what I'm planning to do right now is start building a talk, which is basically talk about two kinds of link analysis approaches. Okay, so basically why are we doing link analysis? It's because the pages are created on the web without any centralized authority, and so large number of these be a humongous amount of variance in the quality. And so you should somehow have to find a way of evaluating the quality of the page before, you know, the user sees it. As I said, user might be able to say whether or not it's relevant to them, but they cannot be sure whether in fact it's the correct information. So that needs to be done before you get it. And so in terms of importance, actually, and we actually talked about, you know, variety of things that can tell us importance, you know, what are the things that you can use to decide on the importance of the source, and then we focused, as at the end of the class we said, we'll first look at the link analysis measures, where basically the pages are sort of defining a social structure because they're pointing to each other. So there are two approaches that I'll talk about. They're very close, but they're skewed enough. They're different enough that it's worth understanding. One of them you probably heard of, PageRank. The other is authorities and hubs. The basic difference is, you know, both of them start with essentially a graph of, if they assume that all pages are vertices in a graph, and if a page P1 has a hyperlink to page P2, you know, you have a directed edge on the graph. Okay, so you have basically directed graphs. Okay, and then lots of hyperlinks. So every time there's a hyperlink, there's a directed edge here. So you have both of them take as their input, both these approaches take as their input this directed graph. Okay. The difference is, in the case of authorities and hubs, you essentially think of two ideas. One is, if the importance of a page, I mean, there are two ways of thinking of importance of a page in authorities and hubs. Authorities are ones that hubs are pointing to, okay? And hubs are ones which are pointing to important authorities, okay? So the best metaphor to think of is, a good textbook is one which talks about important things that were done in the area. Okay? So for example, if you have a IR textbook which doesn't at all talk about latent semantic indexing, that's a kind of a bad textbook. Okay? And so a good textbook talks about all the important things that got done in the area. And a good idea, like a latent semantic indexing, becomes important because textbooks are talking about it. You see what I'm saying? If it's not important enough, then textbooks don't talk about it. Textbooks are sort of like surveys of good ideas. Okay? So a hub and authority is the way you look at it in the authorities hubs idea. So your mental picture is there are important people to whom important agents are pointing to. So in the Hollywood metaphor, the stars, the movie stars are the authorities, and their agents are the hubs. And sometimes a single agent might be actually representing multiple stars, right? Okay, and then so the question then, so that's the view you have, and then using that you want to provide to each node in the network an authority score and an hub score, okay? In the pure sort of a scenario where textbooks don't say anything original whatsoever, and original papers don't have any kind of a survey, then original papers only have authority scores, textbooks only have hub scores. But many a time, a great textbook is one which also synthesizes things and brings up new ideas that were not understood before that. Okay, so a textbook could have both a hub score and an authority score. And similarly, a good paper, a good original contribution paper might also have a good related work section, which talks about how, you know, other important things that were done in the area. So a good authority paper might also have a little of a hub score. Okay, so in general, in the authorities hub's view of the world, pages have both an authority score and a hub score, and then your interest is to provide as result some of the important authorities and some of the important hubs that are relevant to this particular query. Okay, so that's the idea that you do in authorities hubs. And so notice, of course, that if you have links pointing to you, it increases your authority. And if you are pointing to others, then it increases your hubness. Okay, and authorities and hubs sort of make a dual, kind of a duopoly, you know. So hubs become important because they're pointing to good authorities. Authorities become important because good hubs are pointing to them. So that's one way we look at it. Okay, now of course, you know, that's a metaphor, that's the basic qualitative understanding. The question is, can I get a consistent set of authority hub scores for this graph? Okay, remember what I said at the end of last class, it's almost impossible to decide what is the true ranking of pages in terms of quality. What does matter is whether or not you are stable. If you actually say this is the most important, this is the second most important, etc., and some small random change occurred, you know, tonight, where some random page made a link to some other random page, and tomorrow morning your ranking completely changes, then that's not a good ranking. Okay, remember I said random link. Okay, it's like if in fact the New York Times page puts a link to you, that's not a random change. That's a highly unrandom change, you know, and of course, in fact, if New York Times page puts a link to your page, you will become very important tomorrow. Okay, but that's not a random change. The possibility that, you know, of all the billions of pages in the world, New York Times would put a link to you is very, very low for me. possibility. So I'm talking about if there's a small random change, the rank should not be changing too much. The quality ranking should not be changing too much. That's something that we will look at. And you know, is there a way, in fact, we can assign scores such that that would happen? Okay. The second way of looking at the same links is using the same exact graph. Now, instead of thinking of authorities and hubs, I think of these basically, if I'm here, let's say I have this random surfer model in my head, okay? So the assumption is that you know, people start on the web at some page, and then read that page for a while, and then basically follow one of the links from that page. Okay, now if there are, from this page, there are four links, so you assume, you know, without basically just by default that if there are n links, you would transfer to each one of these links with one of n probability. Okay, so if you have, you know, in this case, four links going out, so you have a four-sided coin, you toss it, and based on what it says, you will actually do the, detect that particular link. And then when you go there, let's say you come here, you know, spend some time, read it, etc., and then you again toss a coin based on what you can do from there. So from in this particular case, if you come here, really only one thing you can do. You don't need a coin. You just take this and come here. Okay? So that's basically the random surfer model. So now the question, of course, is whatever I said just now, it actually sets up a Markov chain. I mentioned that people should look at Markov chains. Basically, here is a Markov chain where you know, these are all the nodes, and then you know, you're essentially starting by occupying one of the nodes, and then it doesn't almost matter, you know, what's the probability that you're in one of the nodes in the beginning. The question that's most interesting in a Markov chain is there a steady state probability that you will find yourself in this node as against some other node? Okay, so irrespective of where you start, as you keep going around, you will wind up actually, you know, at steady state, there is a certain probability that you'll find yourself in any one of these states. And that won't change anymore. The question is there such a steady state probability? And if so, you can then say the pages that you're more likely to spend more time on, which the pages which have a higher steady state probability, are somehow more important because everybody seems to kind of go there. Okay, so the question then, so in this case, in the second idea, we just look at the same exact graph as a Markov chain and then try to compute its steady state probability. Okay, what's interesting is that both authorities hubs and Markov chain steady state probabilities are connected to primary eigenvector of the matrix. Both are connected to the primary eigenvector of the matrix. It just turns out that they happen to be different matrices. In one case, it will be a symmetric matrix AAT, we'll talk about in a minute. In another case, it's just the transition matrix. Okay. So again, the eigenvectors don't leave us still. It turns out they are still important. Okay. And those correspond to the steady state probabilities. Okay. By the way, if you are paying attention, in this particular Markov chain, what is the steady state probability distribution? It's, for example, actually, in fact, I can make it slightly more interesting. Okay. Now we can see what happens. In the steady state, everybody just comes here.
Yeah.
Right, because in essence, you come here, you'll never get out. These are called sink states. So people, you know, people come in there, they can't get out. Okay, so here is an interesting picture that you have. I mean, again, we'll get back to this when we talk more about Markov chains. If you directly try to apply the notion of Markov chain here, you have a sink node here. It's like you basically, once you have a sink node, then essentially all the probability mass just gets concentrated on the sink node. Okay, what's more interesting is, suppose I did not have this. Then what would have happened? Then it would be either this or this. And if you reach this, you will never go anywhere else. If you reach this, you'll never go anywhere else. So is there a unique steady state probability? No, there are two different steady states. And I'm interested in figuring out unique steady state problems. So for these kinds of reasons, we'll notice that even though this is the Markov chain you're looking at, we really don't want to, we need to do some doctoring to the Markov chain so that there won't be any sink nodes, for example. What I'm saying? Okay. And you know, metaphorically speaking, it's not like if you go to a page, how many of you went to a page and there were no links out of that page and you said, what do I do? I'm stuck here. I cannot go anywhere else. You don't do that, right? Right? Exactly what do you do, by the way? If you went to a page and you can't come back, what? Exactly, right? I mean, so essentially, you have, if you get sick and tired of a page, you have, and you can't go anywhere from this page, then there are certain pages that you find yourself in more often than not. You have a reset distribution. If you're doing nothing else, then you're likely to be in those pages. Okay? So that's one way you can get out of this kind of a sink situation. So whenever you're in a sink node, you just happen to go to your reset distribution. We'll talk about that. Okay, so that's basically the two views that we look at. Okay? Yes?
So you mentioned 2.1 is steady state, another is like users spending more time on a particular page.
Mm-hmm.
But when we think about two types of search engines, how will it come to know whether users are spending more time?
No, they don't. That's not, they're not actually capturing. So the interesting thing is, in fact, if you're trying to figure out where are people spending more time on, actual real time, there are ways of doing this now, but that's not what link analysis does. Link analysis assumes that basically even without actually capturing the amount of time you spend on the page, it's just basically looking at how likely are you to find yourself on this page. Do you see what I'm saying?
It's meant to find out steady state.
Steady state occupancy probability. Oh. So the probability that you'll occupy this state in steady state. Anyway, we'll come back to that later. And in the same exact picture, you have other reason hubs too. In this particular case, this guy has zero hub score, but an authority score, for example. Because people are pointing to it, it's not pointing to anybody. Right? And then this guy has basically, but for this link, this guy only has a hub score. He's only pointing to other pages. Nobody other than this poor guy is pointing to it. Okay, so that's a different way of looking at the same exact graph, and we'll do both of them. Okay. Yes?
State definition is what is the probability you will stay on that page?
So after the Markov chain has reached steady state, then what you'll do is you'll take a snapshot and see where the surfer is. Another snapshot where the surfer is. So you take 10 million, I mean, let's say 10,000 snapshots. Okay, of them, in 100 of them, is in this state. So then the steady state probability is 100 by 10,000 for P1. You see what I'm saying? Now, unbeknownst to you, if you do this after you're just done with the 10,000, if you were to do another 10,000 and you get completely different numbers, then that means the probability has not reached steady state. Do you see what I'm saying? So it's like the word steady state, it's not that the surfer is stuck in one place and not changing at all. It's the probability distribution that's not changing anymore. Okay? Okay, so when we are looking at authorities and hubs, of course, this is basically the point I made already, that you have authorities, you have hubs, and a page that references a lot of important pages is a hub, and a page that is referenced to by many pages is an authority. Authorities become important because hubs point to them. Hubs become important because authorities they're pointing to the right authorities. Okay? So that's the basic idea. So the question, of course, is there a way, as I said, the metaphors of authorities hubs are textbook, for example, versus original paper. Okay? Are publicity agent and a star in the Hollywood. Okay? This is actually, how many of you know that there used to be a Soviet Union? I don't know when people are born anymore, okay? So when Soviet Union existed, it turns out this is a joke about Soviet Union. So this guy from, Western Hemisphere goes to Soviet Russia, and he's being shown around the places, And Soviet Union, I mean, actually, I actually did my calculus from a book when I was in undergrad study, from my book called Pushkinov's Calculus. And it's a beautiful textbook. Soviet mathematicians, Russian mathematicians are some of the best. Okay, so in fact, they have done many original things. We just happen to have mentioned a Russian mathematician today already. Does anybody remember?
Markov.
Right. Anything which ends in an O is a Right? Kolmogorov complexity, Markov, Chebyshev inequality, everything, you know, lots and lots of mathematicians. So they have done a lot of mathematics, but one of the interesting things about Soviet Union is that they used to have this complex that everything, in my textbook, in the differential equations, there is, you know, Bernoulli's rule. They would call it Ostrogradansky formula. Okay, as if there are not enough Russian mathematicians inventing stuff, this Russian book says everything invented must have been invented by a Russian. Okay, so this was a known fact about Soviet Union. So anyway, this guy goes to Soviet Union, and his friend is showing him around, and he says, oh, this particular building, this is the tallest building in the world, it's invented by Popov. This particular something, it's the best thing in the world, it's invented by Popov. So he's going around showing everything that everything was invented by Popov. So obviously, this man is very impressed with this Popov character and says, so Popov must be the most important person in Soviet Union, right? Okay? And his friend says, no, he's the second most important person in Soviet Union. Who is the first most important person? The guy who created or invented Popov. Right? The interesting point about it is Popov is an authority, but in some sense somebody made up this Popov guy, you know, who didn't exist. Okay. So I find this joke makes me remember differences between authorities and hubs. Okay. Anyway, and also in politics, kings and kingmakers. Kingmakers are hubs and kings are authorities. Okay. The fact that I have so many analogies means authorities and hubs is a pretty normal day-to-day concept that we use already, and so we are just trying to use it in the internet. Okay, so you have authorities and hubs. This is like a simplified picture. Here there are only pure authorities and a pure hubs, but it is not required that hubs don't have any backlinks. As I said, in my case, there is a backlink to this guy. Okay, so but we can think in this as like the simplified picture. Okay, so what I would do is I want to kind of give some authority scores and hub scores. At this point, these guys. One idea is the following. Let's just give some random numbers to begin with. Let's say everybody has authority score 1 and hub score 1. Everybody. Then you look around your neighborhood and check whether you should be changing your score. Okay, so for example, we started by saying everybody has authority score 1, hub score 1. Okay, so now you start. This guy looks at the neighborhood, he realizes that, he or she realizes that there are 3 links to it. So really, its authority score should be the hub value scores, the sum of the hub value scores of these 3 guys. I know that normally hubness is a function of who is, your authority is a function of the hubs. I'll assume that the function is a simple function, just summation of hub scores. Okay, so in the very first iteration, I will notice that I was thinking I was a poor guy. I'm just an authority 1, but it turns out there are these 3 guys who are pointing to me. They currently have hub scores 1, 1, 1. So must be my authority is 3. Okay, and then somewhere along the line, this guy would be thinking, I always thought that my hub score was 1, but look, I'm actually pointing to some guy who has an authority 3. And another guy was an authority 2. So my hub score must be 5. Okay? This is a localized reassignment of your authority and hub scores, iteratively. Okay? The only question, of course, is if I do this, if I keep doing this, would I just get to a constant set of authority, a stable set of authorities and hub values? The most interesting thing that you'll find out today is yes, you will. That's the only reason to come to the classroom. Okay, so there are many iterative approaches, and the good iterative approaches reach a fixed point. This one actually reaches a fixed point. Okay, so I'm assuming that the way I would do the operations is that the authority, if you start with some arbitrary distribution of authorities and hubs, so let's assume everybody has 1, 1, 1. That's fine. You could also start with some other set of authorities and hub values for all the nodes. What's interesting is whatever we do doesn't depend on the initial score. Okay, if it does, then you're in big trouble because you don't know what to guess. Okay, I would assume that I just, you know, if I don't say anything else, let's assume we just put 1, 1, 1. And then every iteration, the node looks around and it's resets its authority score to be the sum of the hub scores of the nodes pointing to it. And similarly, it resets its hub score to be the sum of the authority scores of the nodes it is pointing to. Okay, that's it. And then now, of course, it has a new set of authorities and hubs. Now, of course, as you do this, you do notice that the numbers are increasing, right? Okay, but what I really care about is not the absolute value of your authority and hub, but rather the relative values. So I'll assume that after every iteration, you know, you can think of it as an authority vector and a hub vector. Authority vector is of the size, the number of nodes of the graph. Hub vector is the size of the number of nodes of the graph. I just, after every iteration, I take the unit vector in the direction of the vector. So that means I just normalize it by L2 norm. Okay, so I take the each value divided by the square root of the square sum of the squares of all the values. That way I will get the unit vector. Right? Let's assume I'm doing this, you know. Because it doesn't make any sense to just, you know, keep increasing overall authority of all the pages combined every iteration. It makes no sense. What really matters is how is the total authority of the universe distributed among you guys? And the total authority is sort of, you know, you're thinking in terms of unit vector. Okay, so we'll do that. So the question then, of course, is as you keep doing this, is this unit vector will be changing directions in the n-dimensional space? Will it reach a particular direction and hang around there? That's the question you're asking yourself. That's what you're asking yourself. Okay. The operations that you do essentially, you know, are in the ith iteration, the authority of the node is said to be, so first of all, let's assume that you have, you know, used the matrix notation and you want to talk about adjacency matrix. And the adjacency matrix, basically, this is P1, P2, P3, P4, P5. So adjacency matrix would have P1, P2, P3, P4, P5. And it would have a 1 in the ijth element if there is a link from I to j.
So it's not a symmetric matrix?
No, it's, you know, it's an adjacency matrix of a directed graph. So it's obviously a symmetric. But it could be a symmetric. Okay? So in this case, P1 is not pointing to itself, so this is 0. P1 is pointing to P2, there is 1 here. P1 is pointing to P3, there is a 1 here. P1 is pointing to 4, this is the 1 here, P1 is pointing to P5, this is the 1 here. Okay, and if I take, let's say, P4, there's P4. P4 basically is only pointing to P5. So 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. And you can, you know, set up the rest of it. That's basically the adjacency matrix. Okay, so now if I want to know who is pointing to me, so this is basically aijth element is telling me that there is a link from I to J. If it is 1, then there is a link from I to J. If I want to know who is pointing to me, which is what I want to know if I'm doing authority computation, okay, then I need to basically know that, so for I'm basically, you know, I'm at node J, I want to know who are all the guys who are actually pointing to me. Okay, so it basically, this is the adjacency matrix. You can also talk about the transpose of the adjacency matrix, which will have a 1 in the ijth element if there is a link from j to I. Okay, that's basically the idea. So if you get that into your head, then you can say that whatever we were doing in terms of summation of authorities and hubs can be written as essentially a matrix operation. Okay, I can write this as the authority is nothing but, in the ith iteration, the authority vector is nothing but the hub vector from the previous iteration, okay, multiplied by A transpose. Just convince yourself that that works. Okay, and similarly, the hub vector is the authority vector multiplied by A. So in essence, every iteration, I was making it look as if you're looking at, each node which looks around and resets its value, but it's actually a single, matrix operation. Okay, so you multiply the original hub vector by A transpose, you get the next authority. You multiply that next authority by the, A, then you'll get the next hub. And then you keep doing this. The question, of course, is as you keep doing this, as I keeps going up from 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., all the way, and remember that every time you do this, we'll assume that we're also doing a unit vector. So after you compute the new vector, you take the unit vector in that direction. That's all you care about. Okay. So the question is, will it reach a fixed point? Okay. And if so, when will it reach a fixed point? Okay. Now, to see this, notice that AI is A transpose times HI minus 1. Then HI minus 1 would be nothing but A times AI minus 1, capital A times AI minus 1. So what that means is AI is nothing but A transpose A times AI minus 1. So really this hub is just a middle point. Authority goes from authority, okay, in two steps. Okay? And similarly, hub will be, A times AI. AI is nothing but A transpose times HI minus 1. So A transpose HI minus 1. Okay? So that's all I wrote there. So AI is nothing but A transpose A times AI minus 1. And HI is nothing but A transpose times HI minus 1. Where the subscripts are the vector in that iteration. The vector of all the hub scores in that iteration. So this is, if I start with I minus 1 iteration hub values, I get the I iteration hub values just by doing A transpose. Now, the good thing for you is what's interesting about A transpose A and AA transpose?
They are symmetric.
Even though you started with directed graph, which means it's an asymmetric matrix. AA transpose and A transpose A would be symmetric by definition. And they would be symmetric, and they're basically correlation matrices. They're symmetric and they're positive, and so in fact, they will have all these good properties, including having positive eigenvectors, positive eigenvalues. But that, we'll wait for that. Now, so if AI is this, now of course, AI minus 1 itself can be written in terms of AI minus 2. So that can be A transpose A square AI minus 2. A transpose A cube AI minus 3, or A transpose A power I A0. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay, so this should remind you what we are doing now. Basically, you took some random vector A0, so actually as I was saying is that AI is nothing but A transpose A power I, that means you multiply this A transpose A matrix I times to itself, and then multiply it to A0. Another way of looking at it is, you multiply A0 by A transpose times A, then once more by A transpose times A, once more by A transpose times A, keep doing this. Okay, now, and similarly for HI, it's from A transpose power I, H0. What's interesting about this? This is what you did in the homework 0. If you take an arbitrary vector, you take a matrix, you keep multiplying this arbitrary vector by the matrix, irrespective of the arbitrary vector you start with, eventually you get the primary eigenvector of the matrix. We did this. That's why we made you do this in homework 0. So basically what we are essentially saying is that if you think of authorities and hubs as being, in this view, that authorities are sums of hubs and hubs are sums of authorities, then in essence, there is a steady state for the authorities and hubs. That would correspond to the primary eigenvector for authorities. The steady state vector is just the primary eigenvector of K transpose A. It doesn't matter what you started with. That's the most interesting thing. The initial authority doesn't matter at all. And similarly, initial hub doesn't matter at all. Right? Okay? So that basically tells you both that this computation makes sense, that you will have a steady state. Okay? And that in that case of also and that in fact the primary eigenvector is what you will get. And so if you actually you can ignore this, so you might then say, why do I bother actually doing this multiple times? Why don't I just take the A transpose A, ask MATLAB to give me the primary eigenvector? Right? That's what is the answer. It turns out that the fastest way to compute the primary eigenvector is this way. Okay? Power iteration is the fastest way to compute primary eigenvector. So if you ask MATLAB, then MATLAB will make an arbitrary A0 and just do power iteration, if that's the only thing it needs to do. Of course, for a small enough matrix, it can do pretty much anything. It can, for example, compute all the eigenvectors and give you the primary one. But if it's a huge matrix and all you want is the primary eigenvector, why waste time computing the rest? Okay, so power iteration is in fact the fastest way to compute the primary eigenvector. And the question of course is, how fast does it converge? How fast does power iteration converge? It goes back to the eigen gap, which is the difference between the primary and secondary eigenvalues of this matrix. If that were to be big, it would converge very fast. If it were to be small, it would converge slow. You don't need to worry about, notice of course that primary eigenvalues can be complex. They can be negative. Okay, but we don't need to worry about it here. Why? Because we have a symmetric matrix. We have A transpose A and A transpose. They're symmetric matrices, positive symmetric. So they're only going to have positive eigenvalues. And so there will be a positive difference between the primary and secondary eigenvalue, which would be at most zero. And if it is zero, you are in bad luck. And if not, then you would, if it's pretty high, then you will, in very few iterations, you will get to the primary eigenvalue. Okay? So that's basically the background on authority subs computation. And as I said, even though you understand the theory in terms of primary eigenvectors, you actually, if you want to do it, if you want to apply, write a little program, you will write the program which basically does this iteratively. And if it makes any difference, start on Thursday, we will actually give you the second part of the project, which basically asks you to compute the authority's hubs vector for a large enough matrix, and also, of course, page number. So you should be paying attention. Okay. So in this case, I'm just showing you some steps, but you should be obviously, looking at the steps and making sure that you get the same numbers if you were doing it at home without me coming here. So assume that everything was set to one, authority has zero hubs. After the first iteration, you would essentially get authorities to be this and the hubs to be this. Yes?
What was A0?
It's just A0 is the initial authorities, that's all one. A0 is the zeroth authority vector. That means the initial authority vector.
But that's not
a
unit vector.
Well, again, remember the important thing is you can always, if I give you a vector, you can always make it a unit vector. Okay? And it's also, nobody is going to really kill you if you did not do this unit transformation, every iteration. Let's say, what?
It may be faster
that way. So for example, what you might do is do k iterations, and then when the coefficients are becoming too large, then you do one unit vector. And then come k more iterations. That's a reasonable thing to do. But if you ever stop at any point, then if you want to ask what is the relative authorities of the pages and relative hubness of the pages, you want to think in terms of the unit vector. Okay? fine. So then you know, this shows that there's a normalization step going on here, which is basically a Q1 will become 1 divided by square root of 1 square plus 0 square plus 3 square plus 2 square. And that would be this number. And so on. Okay? And then the same thing you can compute for hubs. And if you keep doing this after two iterations, you know, if you're looking at the unit vector, after two iterations, it starts looking like this. And after five iterations, you will notice after five iterations that Q1 and Q2 actually, in this particular case, they're saying all of them are zero authority, which is kind of interesting. Because Q1 should not have zero authority. But Q2 and Q3 will have zero authority, because nobody is pointing to them. Right? And then similarly, the hubness of the Q3 and Q1 would be higher than that of Q2. Because Q2 is only pointing to one guy, whereas Q1 and Q3 are pointing to two guys. But that's not necessary either, because actually the one guy that Q2 is pointing to is actually the most important guy. Okay? So, you know, these are the numbers that you're getting after the iterations, and that sort of, you can see is, look at this, look at the graph, and see whether the authorities seem to make sense. Now, for a small graph, you can check. For a web-sized graph, you have no way. You just have to assume that the approach is working fine. Yes?
The hub of B1 should also not be zero.
What?
The hub of B1.
Hub of B1 also should not be zero. Well, actually, it's an interesting question. It's possible that, here is an interesting thing. Actually, this is after five iterations. If you were to do this, one way this might resolve, notice that here, when you started, the hubness of P1 was, hubness of P1 is 1, okay? But eventually, you might actually notice, this is actually what MATLAB says. Let's look at this. Okay, so that was only five iterations, okay? So here, again the same graph, okay? And I gave the adjacency graph of this to MATLAB, and I asked it for the eigenvectors for A transpose and A transpose A. Okay? So, first of all, this is the eigenvalues. Notice that the eigenvalues would be the same for A transpose and A transpose A. That's what you actually used in the SVDs, right? SVD basically uses MM transpose M transpose M. Both of them will have the same eigenvalues, square roots of which become the singular values. Okay, now notice that in this case the diagonal matrix is put this way, so this is the most important, second most, third most. Okay, so now the hub authorities vector is this. And the authorities vector is basically saying P1 and P2 get all the authority, everybody else gets zero authority. In the steady state. Okay? And similarly, the hub one says only Q1, Q2, Q3 get hubness, the other two guys get zero hubness. So your intuition and my intuition is transitory. In the beginning, it looks like, in the first couple of iterations, it does look like P1 should have some amount of hubness because Q1 does have authorityness. But I can make both of them be consistent by setting this guy's hub to be zero and this guy's authority to be zero. You see what I'm saying? And that's actually what happened in this case. Okay? You can actually make sense of this in this case because, in fact, all this is saying is Q3 and Q1 have higher authority than Q2. I'm sorry, higher hubness than Q2. And similarly, P1 and P2 P1 has higher authority than P2. Okay? And the way you normalize the unit vector, basically I did L2 normalization. That means I basically, there's this whole idea of if you have a vector, then you can talk about L1 norm and L2 norm and so on. L2 norm is the one that you know of, which is basically the x I x square plus y square plus this square plus blah blah. In fact, the vector is x, y, z, so on. Then the L2 norm is square root of x square plus y square plus z square. Okay, the L1 norm is just absolute value of x plus absolute value of pi plus absolute value of c. That's the L1 norm. Okay, you could actually, you know, you might consider, in fact, in a later place, what we are more interested in is not a unit vector in the page rank. We are more interested in having these numbers define a probability distribution. So there you just take a bunch. If I give you a bunch of numbers and say make it into a probability distribution, what do? You add up those numbers. That will give the sum of the numbers. So I'm assuming, hopefully, originally all of the numbers are positive to begin with. Then you can add up all these numbers and divide every one of the original numbers by the sum. That way now you have probabilities. It's a probability distribution model. Okay? So there are multiple ways of normalization. L1 norm is what we'll use for the page rank. Here typically people use L2 norm. Okay. But ultimately what matters is this is somehow 0.65 is bigger than 0.36. Okay. And in fact, this is an interesting point that as you know, your intuitions are typically about transitory values about a local neighborhood. Okay? But the overall steady state will take into account everybody having a certain consistent set of authority hub values, so that everybody's authority hub values would remain the same even if you were to update them again. One of the interesting things about the steady state is once you reach the steady state, so notice the point. If I were to give these as the authority values and these as the hub values, and I do one more iteration, you can convince yourself that the authorities don't change, hubs don't change anymore. That's why it is steady state. Do you see what I'm saying? Okay. So that's one way of making sure that everything, you know, when you go from iteration to iteration, it's going to be consistent. Okay. So this is just basically pointing out that when you, whatever we saw is not magic. In fact, when you apply multiply a matrix by a vector, in essence, what you are considering is you take that vector and take its projection in all the eigenvector directions of the matrix. Okay, so let's look at this actually. So this is a good picture to understand. If you think of a matrix M, for now assume it's a symmetric and positive, which is a good one. Then you can think of its eigen decomposition, which is some eigenvectors times a diagonal matrix of eigenvalues times E transpose, which is also E inverse. Right? And what's interesting is, if you were to multiply m squared, m times m, then the interesting thing is that you should be able to see that m times m is e lambda e inverse 1 times e times e lambda e inverse 1. Now this and this becomes identity. Then lambda times lambda becomes lambda squared. Right? So this is nothing but e lambda squared e minus 1. Okay, lambda is a diagonal matrix. So m power k, one way of thinking of power iteration of a matrix is when you take the power of the kth power of matrix m, then in a sense you're keeping the vectors the same, the eigenvectors the same. It's just that the eigenvalues are getting powered. It's a beautiful insight about what happens when you actually multiply a matrix by itself. Okay, now when I do this, so m power k is nothing but e lambda power k e inverse. Okay, e inverse is nothing but e transpose. Okay, and where both of those are orthonormal basis for the original matrix. Now, I can write this also as, since it's a symmetric real value matrix, you know that lambda 1 is going to be greater than or equal to all the other lambdas. Okay, so what I'll do is I will divide this diagonal matrix lambda. Every point in the diagonal matrix, I will divide by lambda 1. Okay? So then what I'll get? Basically, I'll get lambda by lambda 1 power k. Actually, this is a mistake here. It's lambda by lambda 1 power k. And of course, I'll also have to, because I divide it here, I have to multiply it by lambda 1 power k. As k increases, lambda by lambda 1 power k, so notice that I had the lambda was like, diagonal matrix, so this is a 7, 4, 3, let's say. Then I'm doing 7 by 7, 4 by 7, 3 by 7. Then I'm power n, power k. This is your high-dimensional apple all over again. You take a number which is less than 1 and exponentiate it, you drive it down to 0. So lambda power k basically will have a 1 here and 0, 0, 0, 0 everywhere else. That's what actually happened. When you multiplied a matrix, power iterated a matrix, in essence, its primary eigenvector becomes exponentially more important than all of its other eigenvectors. And so when you then multiply a vector by this matrix, it's almost as if you took that vector into that particular primary eigenvector direction. To understand that, you realize that any arbitrary vector x0 can be written as a linear combination of its projections into all the eigenvector directions. Okay, then so any arbitrary vector can be done this way, and then if I multiply x0 by m power k, notice that only this will survive, everything else will have to die. Right, because everything else has zeros. Okay, so this sort of explains, this picture explains why when you do power iteration, you will essentially wind up going into the primary eigenvector, irrespective of where you started from. It doesn't matter where you started from. If you started with a different initial vector, you would just have a different summation. What matters ultimately is that it does have a projection in the primary eigenvector direction. That should also tell you when does this method not work. When does this method not work? I just told you. What? No, it's nothing to do with eigengap. I said basically it doesn't matter what vector I start with. All that matters is that vector has, essentially, if it were a new vector, that will also have projections on E1, E2, etc. As long as this projection is not zero, you're fine. So if you are one of those unlucky people and who picks a random vector in the world, and it is actually turns out to be orthogonal to the primary eigenvector. You couldn't have done it on purpose, right? Because you had no clue what the primary eigenvector was to begin with. It's just you are one of these people who, when they walk on the road, get hit by buses, okay? And so you picked a vector whose projection in the primary eigenvector direction happens to be zero. And so then you're just, doing power iteration. And that doesn't get you anywhere because you have, your projection in the primary eigenvector direction is being multiplied compared to everybody else. But that is zero to begin with. So you do not actually go to the fixed point lambda of the eigenvector. You see what I'm saying? Now, if you understand this, you can also understand this, which I probably can say anyway. How much more can I lose you in one class? Which is that if you realize that power iteration is the fastest way to get the primary eigenvector, and you want to now get the secondary eigenvector using the same power iteration, what can you do? That tells you how to do it. Basically, first get the primary eigenvector, okay, and then subtract from the original matrix the primary eigenvalue times the primary eigenvector times its transpose. That would give you a new matrix M2 which has the same exact eigenvectors as the original matrix, except its primary eigenvalue happens to be zero. Okay, so just because your eigenvalue is zero doesn't mean that the vector is not existent. In fact, many a time I may have shown you in the previous cases that when you did SVD, there are some. So remember that when you did, you might do SVDs where some of the dimensions are zero. That means there are singular values in those dimensions are zero, but you still get eigenvectors in for those dimensions. It's basically you're just not multiplying anything. You do have a direction; it just happens to have zero portion. Okay. By the way, this reminds me, as if it's not enough, that how many of you have heard of string theory? We are, after all, in 16-dimensional space, according to string theories. What happened to these other dimensions? Okay? Their argument is, essentially those dimensions exist, but their lambdas, their coefficients are so small that you never see them. So you could be in a higher dimensional space, but the coefficients for those are small. That's basically what we constructed here. We constructed a matrix M2 whose primary eigenvector is, for which E1 is still an eigenvector, but its eigenvalue for E1 is 0. So then everything else becomes, the secondary eigenvector now becomes the primary eigenvector for M2. And now if you do power iteration on M2, you get secondary. Okay? Any questions before I move to page rank, which 15 minutes is more than enough for page rank? Okay, so that's authority's house. So next, we'll look at the same graph, and we'll act as if it's a Markov chain. Okay? And so what do we do now? As I said, essentially, think of each of these edges. These are vertices of the graph and in the Markov chain. And then there are transition probabilities. If you have, let's say, k outgoing edges, then with 1 over k probability, you go from, if you take this edge and this edge or this edge. Catch your Markov chain. Okay, so now notice that if I have this particular matrix, and if I have the adjacency matrix, then if I were to take the A transpose of that matrix and then normalize the columns, okay? So if I take A transpose of this matrix, let's just write this matrix down since we are here anyway. P2, tell me what happens for P2. P2 goes back to P1 and everything else.
Zero.
Right? And P3, everything is zero for P3. It's a sync node. Okay? And for P5, everything is zero too. That's matrix A. Okay? If I were to take the transpose of that matrix, I will get 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. That's basically, just for this second column. And then again, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And the third column, and the fourth column is again 1, 0, 0. And the fifth column is 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. Columns become rows. Now, basically, this corresponds to the P1 column. Now, if I normalize it by saying, take the column sum and divide it, each element by the column sum. For that column. And similarly, for this, it will be 1 by 1. And again, everything else, this is 0, of course, this is 1 by 1. If you do this, then you will essentially get each column would be a probability vector. It will be a probability distribution. And that tells you the probability with which, if you start from that node, you would go to any of the other nodes. Okay? So that's your Markov chain matrix. That Markov chain probability matrix. Okay? If you start with that and you compute the steady state distribution of that Markov chain. Okay? And that would then, you want to consider that to be the importance of the page. Okay, the steady state probability distribution. Okay? So, here is my simple, in this case I have just like a different example. And I wrote the adjacency matrix here, and the M matrix, which is the what's called a stochastic matrix or the Markov chain matrix, is the transpose of this matrix with the columns normalized. So I have this. So in this case, every column adds up to 1. Okay, except any 0 columns, in which case they will add up to 0. Okay, now you should never be actually having Markov chain matrices with 0 columns, because that means they're bad Markov chains. But we already talked about that. That means there's a sync there. But, we'll get to that in steps. So in this case, you know, they have a matrix M, which is the stochastic matrix. And the way you actually talk about the steady state of a Markov chain is if I give you M, I'll assume that there is a P0 distribution, the initial probability distribution. Okay? And then P1 is MP0. And P2 is MP1, which is M squared P0. Okay? Now, you would say this has reached steady state if basically Pk is M power k P0. Okay? And you would say it has reached steady state if Pk and Pk plus 1 are the same. By the way, that's how you will realize that if you're doing power iteration, the way you would have realized that you have reached a fixed point is between two iterations, the vector hasn't changed. Okay? So in this case, I would just basically compute, you know, I keep recomputing the probability vector, and when it doesn't change between two iterations, then I have reached fixed point. And since these are real values, sometimes they might be changing in the 15th decimal place. So the normally what you would do is you would take that difference between two vectors, which can be defined, for example, as the difference, the maximum difference between those vectors in any single dimension. So that means take dimension by dimension differences of the vectors and take the maximum of those values. So for example, if I have a vector 4, 3, 1, 2, another vector 5, 1, 7, 4, then the difference here is 1, the difference here is 2, the difference here is 6, the difference here is 2, and so 6 is the maximum difference. I would say that distance between these two vectors is 6. Okay? And that actually turns out that that's the L infinity norm. What that basically means is, you know, L2 norm, you're doing x squared plus y squared plus z squared square root. Okay? And the LP, the pth norm, would be x power p, y power p, z power p, pth root. If you take infinite level, then basically everything else dies out compared to this. So it's like you're just taking the largest value. It's called infinite. Okay, anyway, so you would consider the difference between the two vectors between two iterations, and you know, if they haven't changed enough, you know, you set up an epsilon value, and if you have not changed more than epsilon between two iterations, you can stop. Okay, so that's what this is saying. I will say the probability distribution Ri plus 1 is M times probability distribution Ri, which in itself, Ri itself is in terms of R0 where you started from. Okay? But you can see actually again that what I'm doing is the power iteration. And when you do power iteration once again, you will converge to the primary eigenvector. This time the matrix is not any longer symmetric. It's a probability matrix. It's a stochastic matrix. Now it turns out that the stochastic matrices have this property that, you know, a matrix is called stochastic matrix if its columns all add up to 1. Each column adds up to 1. That means each column is setting up a distribution. Okay, so if you have a stochastic matrix, then if you take eigenvalues of that eigendecomposition of the stochastic matrix, you can be sure that the primary eigenvalue would be 1. And that would be the largest. And the other ones could be actually, would be complex. But the primary one would be real, and it would be 1. Okay? And what you're going to be converging to is the primary eigenvector of this matrix. Okay? The only question, of course, is, will it happen all the time? Will it always happen? Okay? Well, it doesn't happen, for example, for this matrix, because you have a sync node, and in fact you have two sync nodes, and so either you get stuck in P5 and that would be your steady state distribution, or you get stuck in P3 and that would be your steady state distribution. Okay, so in general, so the question that you are asking yourself is, are we sure that the fixed point will always occur for Markov chains? And There is a whole theory about Markov chains, but the part that you need to care about for this class is as long as a Markov chain is both aperiodic and irreducible, then it is guaranteed to have a steady state distribution, a unique steady state distribution. And remember, all that matters is that you have a unique steady state distribution. Nobody really knows who is more important than who. If you keep asking me twice, I should change my importance values. And this would be a unique steady state distribution. Okay, now what is the aperiodicity and what is the irreducibility? So aperiodicity essentially means that the entire Markov chain is not a single big cycle. Okay? And irreducibility essentially is also called ergodicity, and what that means is from every node you can reach every other node with non-zero probability. Okay? You may not have thought about this, but it turns out